Okay, hello everybody, and welcome to this OpenStack Newton on OCP hardware presentation, where we will go through how perfectly these different open source projects fit together. My name is Juha Aravainen, I'm working for Nokia, and I'm coming from Mobile Networks Architecture and Technology Unit.
Hi, my name is Juha Kosonen. I work as a software architect on the same organization as Juha.
Agenda of our presentation is such that Juha, okay, Juha and Juha, so Juha Kosonen, first go through this OCP and what OCP is all about. Then I will cover this OPNFV part and I'm telling you what is OPNFV and what is OpenStack's role in OPNFV. And then we will go through what kind of tests have been made with open source software on top of open source hardware. And at the end of our presentation, we have a short summary. Okay, Juha, please go on.
Thank you. So a little bit of OCP history for a start. In 2009, Facebook was offering new services and giving millions of people a platform, for example, to share photos and videos. They realized that it had to rethink its infrastructure to adapt the huge influx of new users and data, and also control costs and energy consumption. To accomplish this, they started a project to design the world's most energy-efficient data center that could cope these challenges at the lowest possible cost. In 2011, Facebook shared its designs with the public and, along with a couple of other companies, launched the Open Compute Project and incorporated the Open Compute Project Foundation. The aim was to create a movement in the hardware space that would bring about the same kind of creativity and collaboration we see in open source software world today. And this is something which is actually happening. The specification and designs are contributed to the Open OCP Foundation through the OCP projects. There are several projects such as server, networking, storage, and also telco, among others. So to put it short, basically the Open Compute Project is redesigning hardware and making it more efficient, flexible, and scalable. Here is the list of OCP Platinum members, or at least this was the situation last week. There are many other companies on other membership levels, so this is just to illustrate that there are members from different areas of the industry. For example, AT&T, Goldman Sachs, Nvidia, Nokia, and so on. Nokia joined the project in November 2015. And why OCP hardware? Well, OCP hardware is cost efficient. It lowers the cost of both infrastructure as well as operational expenses too. It's a vanity-free design without unnecessary components and materials. Disaggregated rack-level solution with common resources like power. Let's see the building blocks a little bit later. From maintenance perspective, a major benefit is the fact that all hardware operations are easily performed from the front of the rack. There is no need to access a rear hot isolate, and no special tools required for these operations. Next, we have a short video demonstrating the process of replacing a faulty server and the time required for it. This is a comparison between OCP hardware and rack mount. The procedure is simply to unplug the cables, remove the faulty server, install a new one, and then plug cables back again. In the video on the left-hand side is the In the video, rack mount is on the left side and OCP on the right. And at first, please pay attention what's going on the right-hand side, because there the work is finished already in a quite early phase. So let's put the video rolling. So pretty nice, and this was only a very simplified example of one unit replacement in a single rack environment. So you can imagine what would be the case in a real data center. And then some more benefits of OCP, the high rack efficiency. OCP 48 servers per rack, rack mount 32. This means a remarkable improvement in rack footprint per compute node. And what comes to the energy efficiency, OCP data center excels also there. And just a quick overview of building blocks. These are from Nokia Airframe portfolio. So there's the rack. This is pretty much similar as 19-inch rack from the width point of view. Then there is power self with 6 power supply units, compute cell for 3 computes, server nodes, storage nodes, and switches. Originally, OCP is not designed to fulfill regulatory requirements from CE and FCC. Nokia Airframe includes several enhancements, such as electromagnetic shielded doors, side panels, and cable openings, improved seismic tolerance, and minus 48 volt DC power feed, since that's what telco equipment is traditionally using. So Nokia Airframe is a telco grade solution. In general, OCP has gained a lot of interest in industry. Some of the major players, such as AT&T, is using Nokia Airframe in OPNFV evaluation, which brings us to the next topic, where Juha tells what OPNFV is and how it connects to the OpenStack.
Okay. Thank you, Juha. So, OPNFV is Open Platform for Network Functions Virtualization. This project was established about 2.5 years ago, and it's a Linux Foundation open source project. And through system level integration, deployment, and testing, OPNFV creates a reference NFV platform to accelerate the transformation of enterprise and service provider networks. So all in all, OPNFV is a reference open source platform. Scope of OPNFV, originally the scope was virtualization layer and virtualized infrastructure managers. So on the right hand side of this slide, you can see those lower layers, NFVI and VIM. So those were the in the scope originally, and NFVI, it means Network Function Virtualization Infrastructure, and Vim is this virtualized infrastructure manager. But later on also MANO was taken into OPNFV scope, so MANO is management and orchestration, and here on the right hand side you can see those VNF manager and NFV orchestrator components. So the current OPNFV scope is inside of that red dot line. And what are the key components of OPNFV? I would say that the OpenStack is de facto virtualized infrastructure manager component at the moment. But whenever you make this OPNFV software build, then of course you need also some other open source components. And actually you have several options how to build this OPNFV software build, and you can choose different kind of open source components. And in OPNFV we are talking about scenarios. So there are quite many scenarios in OPNFV. So in addition of this OpenStack, if you want to take, for example, SDN controller into this OPNFV software build, you can choose if you want to take Open Daylight or ONAP or Open Contrail. And then, of course, you need also Linux, and you can use, for example, CentOS or Ubuntu or maybe something else. And to mention some other components, so there is, for example, this Open vSwitch, so that you can take only the Open vSwitch, or you can take also with DPDK. So there are all kind of or different kind of options how to build this OPNFV software build. And in OPNFV we have several installers which installs the build in the way you like. And in the latest OPNFV Danube release, also the first MANO functionalities came into OPNFV. OPNFV member companies, so there are different kind of membership levels, and there are a lot of companies in OPNFV nowadays. And just to mention a few of them, you can see that there are big operators like AT&T and China Mobile, for example. There are vendors like Nokia, Huawei, Ericsson, and so on. And in addition of that, there are also some other big players like Intel and Red Hat, among others. So all in all, there are now over 50 member companies in OPNFV, and OPNFV is a quite big open source community nowadays. OPNFV has a 6 months release cadence, and these releases are named after rivers, and they follow alphabetical order. So Arno was the first OPNFV release, then came Brahmaputra and Colorado, and the latest one is Danube. And this Danube was released about 1 month ago. And Euphrates works has just been started. So there are 4 releases so far, and more is coming. And if you wonder which OpenStack versions are used in these OPNFV releases, so then I can tell you that Liberty was used in Brahmaputra, Mitaka was used in Colorado, and Newton is now in this latest Danube release. Okata was actually already available when this Danube was released, but Okata came out so short time before Danube that it was not possible to take Okata anymore into use. And this e-release work has just been started, and OpenStack, Okata or Bike will be used in e-release, but I'm not sure because this work has just been started, that whether it's been decided which one of those two OpenStack versions will be used in OPNFV e-release. But all in all, there is a new OpenStack version in every new OPNFV release. And here you can see the OPNFV release history. So Arno was the first OPNFV release, and it came out a little bit less than 2 years ago. And it was the baseline foundation of components necessary to build an NFV platform from upstream components. And then during 2016, OPNFV Brahmaputra and Colorado were released. And the latest OPNFV release is Danube, which brings together end-to-end networking stacks, including management and orchestration, data plane acceleration, and architecture advancements. And if we take a little bit more detail, this Danube, so that what now came out. So, like mentioned already a couple of times, so this management and orchestration is now also in the scope, and OpenO project brought some MANO functionalities to OPNFV. Okay, there has been some changes lately, so this ONAP project was established lately, and this ONAP is Open Network Automation Platform, and it is the latest open source MANO project. And it actually put together OpenO and eComp open source projects. Then there are some architectural improvements like network control flexibility, high availability, and multi-site improvements. And in NFV performance area, there are some data plane acceleration. And for example, this FDIO has nowadays its OPNFV project. And in this OVSD, PDK, and KVM, or those components are naturally improving all the time. Then there are some feature improvements, and like mentioned here, IPv6 and SFC and layer 2 and 3 VPN, fault management, and so on. And this OPNFV supports multiple hardware architectures. So you can run it on top of x86 hardware or ARM hardware, and it works also on top of this OCP open source hardware. Then one other thing which I like to mention from OPNFV, that so that in OPNFV we have these public labs. So on the right upper hand side corner, you can see that there are these public OPNFV laboratories around the globe, hosted by different OPNFV member companies. And these laboratories are meant for CI and CD purposes and testing of this OPNFV platform. And Faros project builds several different kind of scenarios and deploys them across the globe on multiple hardware platforms. And if you wonder what this Faros is, so Faros is an OPNFV project, and it's OPNFV laboratory infrastructure project which develops OPNFV labs infrastructure that is geographically and technically diverse. And Nokia is also having one OPNFV public laboratory. It's in Espoo, Finland. And currently it's a rack mount hardware-based laboratory, but we have a plan that we will expand OPNFV public labs with OCP-based hardware in the near future. And last but not least, from this OPNFV point of view is this cross CI, XCI. So this XCI is a service provided to OPNFV community and the community's OPNFV work to enable early integration, faster feedback, alignment, and reuse. So if, for example, in OpenStack somebody makes a patch, then there is own testing pipe in OpenStack side, and all those test phases needs to be passed so that this patch will be taken into the software build. But this cross CI system, it expands this methodology to all these testing phases so that OPNFV can take the latest OpenStack version from the main branch and then it tests that how this latest OpenStack version works together with all these other open source components. And if there is some bugs or some interoperability problems, so then the feedback loop comes much faster. So the idea is to discover these bugs in OPNFV environment faster and fix them. And there are some plans also with some other open source communities. And then we go to the testing part.
Yes. Let's start with the discussion with the event called OPNFV Plugfest. Plugfest is an event organized twice a year after a new OPNFV release. It focuses areas like OPNFV deployment, release, network integration, VNFs, and in general it tries to accelerate the open technology development and commercial adoption. The second OPNFV Plugfest was hosted by University of New Hampshire Interoperability Laboratory in Durham. And Nokia participated this event too. And actually, this was the first time OCP was used in Plugfest. So there were 70 people from 23 different companies on organization attending to this event. And the event itself is not only for OPNFV members, but is open for non-members too. And in this Plugfest, Nokia's main focus was in installer and dovetail testing. In OPNFV, there are several installers that can be used for doing the actual deployment. And Plugfest provides an opportunity for installer projects to run deployment against different sets of hardware. In that sense, running deployments on unfamiliar hardware helps to validate that design of each project is portable across multiple vendors' hardware platforms. And similarly, this enables also hardware vendors to test and validate the compatibility of OPNFV software deployments on their products. The deploy and test activities allow many participants to get hands-on experience with OPNFV software as well. And about this dovetail testing, so what does this actually mean in this context? OPNFV Board of Directors has initiated compliance verification program, which is known as CVP. The program's objective is to enhance interoperability and reduce adoption risk and testing costs for end users by verifying hardware and software platform interfaces and components. The verified products may have different features and capabilities, but they are all expected to have compliant by implementing exactly defined interfaces, behaviors, and key features. Dovetail is the project that delivers open source software tool chain documentation and test suite for this CVP. And it leverages many OPNFV and upstream projects to accomplish this. The OPNFV certification and compliance committee can award a product OPNFV ready status if product passes the compliance verification suite. This verification process itself is not yet effective, but we are expecting this to happen later in this year. And this is the airframe setup we had there on site on the Plugfest. It's this sort of a half rack size. There are six server nodes and data management switches and power shelf. So it's the very same building blocks we saw already earlier. And all in all, Nokia Airframe got a lot of interest from participants in this event, since it was nice to have the hardware physically located in the same space where people was working, so everybody had a chance to really see the setup. And the Bugfest report is publicly available on opnfv.org. Test activities, bugs discovered and reported to OPNFV project teams, participant lists and things like that, that they are all described on the report. And the next Bugfest was in April after OPNFV Danube release. This was organized by Orange in their premises in Châtillon near Paris. So big thanks to Orange for making this true. At this time, topics such as DPDK and INIX were our team's main interest, and we had a lot of good cooperation and with many people, especially on issues related to these topics, among other topics, of course. An event like this provides a good opportunity to meet face-to-face experts from different companies and organizations to collaborate and utilize their expertise on the work currently in hand. So, and this Danube Bugfest report is not out yet. And then a few words about VNF testing in Nokia internal OPNFV test labs. So the VNF means this virtualized network function, which basically you can think the VNF as a real network element, for example, a base station deployed on the network function virtualization infrastructure. In Nokia OPNFV test labs, we are running our commercial VNFs on top of OPNFV using different hardware and also commercial NFV platforms. And by using a different combination of hardware and platform in testing, it helps us to verify the capabilities of underlying platform and to identify the potential effects it may have on VNF side. So, and next, a short recap by Juha.
Okay, thanks. So, short summary. And so this open source software and open source hardware is now leading us to an open future. So this open source ecosystem, it is the way to accelerate the introduction of new NFV products and services. Traditionally, open source projects have been working mainly inside their own communities, but nowadays cooperation between these open source communities is increasing all the time, like we have described in this presentation. So vendors, service providers, enterprises, and individuals are all consumers of open source, but at the same time, they can also be contributors to open source projects, which is great. And we already mentioned this OPNFV Bugfest in this presentation, and OPNFV Bugfest are a great place to collaborate, and I suggest you all to read these Bugfest reports. Bugfests are organized twice a year, and the latest Bugfest was organized a couple of weeks ago in Paris. Report is not yet ready, but it will come out in the near future. And actually these two sentences are directly from this latest Bugfest report, and there you can see that many OPNFV community members were able to deploy and test OPNFV for the first time with this OCP-based hardware. And this OCP gained a lot of attention in this event, and the community is looking forward more collaboration opportunities between these open source communities. And in open source, stakeholders are CSPs, vendors, and also individuals. and openness leads to faster innovation cycles and lower vendor lock-in. Bigger, better, and faster results can be achieved with shared innovation, research, and development. Open source allows shared R&D between CSPs and vendors, and nowadays also customers can create new features directly in open source communities by contributing. So instead of creating a feature request towards vendors, customers can also contribute directly to open source projects. In open source, global communities come together around a shared purpose, and communities are able to create things that go beyond the capabilities of any person. So, we have told you some examples from the cooperation between different open source projects, and it looks like the future is built on openness, and open source is one important part of in that. New technology will leverage open source right from the beginning, whereas current networking technology evolves to a cloud-native future that also builds heavily on open source. And more is needed. In the future, factory robots will communicate wirelessly and cars on the highways will exchange the information with each other. This requires extremely low latency mobile networks known as 5G. The first cloud networks have already been deployed, but more is needed with future networks as more functionalities will be moved to the cloud. So I would say that the future looks interesting and even more cooperation is needed. And this was the end of our presentation, and we want to thank you from your time. And now it's time for questions.
Can you estimate the penetration of the OCP platforms in data centers and NFV specialized data centers? How many data centers are out there that are actually running OCP hardware versus common off-the-shelf, one-U servers, other modular platforms?
I would say that this goes maybe a little bit out of the scope of our presentation, so we just told you that what kind of cooperation we have been made with all these open source communities. So I don't have the market figures so that I could tell you that how popular this OCP hardware is at the moment. So sorry, I can't answer this kind of question.
Another question, compared to a similarly equipped, say, one-U server. You mentioned in early in your presentation that there were cost advantages to running OCP hardware. I would then expect that there will be, like, an OCP board would be like 30% cheaper, X percent cheaper than a one-U server. I don't really find that to be the case. Can you comment on that?
Can I comment the density? So
I think maybe the density is one issue, so that you can get the more of these compute nodes power in the same footprint.
And so if I understood the question correctly, so you mean that the one server is not cheaper, and maybe that's the case, but when you make big data centers, so then you can gain the benefits there.
Okay, thank you.
Hi. I have a question related to the architecture, a roadmap, or do you have any update or any insight in terms of something similar to rack scale distributed architecture or similar distributed architecture in terms of OCP?
Rack scale architecture, well, I would say that this goes also a little bit out of the scope, because the main idea of this presentation was this cooperation, and so there is also OCP stand in the marketplace, so if you want to discuss with those guys, but then this other technology, so
okay.
I can help you with that, unfortunately. Okay, obviously no other questions, so thank you for your time.